A run through of our battle reenactment, and we're getting our cattle, as which you can see, we've got plenty of livestock, okay, and we're going to have to drive them back over the island. So let's have some fun with this. Give us about 10 or 15 minutes, and then our cookout is going to be working while we're going through this. The reenactment, we expect to take about 15 to 20 minutes, okay? So just enjoy the beautiful weather, keep an eye on those kayaks, and I will see you soon.
Vamos a comenzar la actividad. Gracias por acompañarnos y a los que nos acompañaron en los kayaks y las canoas, gracias también. Y en un momento también vamos a comenzar a poder usar los kayaks y las canoas en esta parte del río Chelsea.
Now, today we don't have cannons and we don't have guns, thank goodness, but we have you. So if you can all pull together closer, please. We have to do a little exercise. Today, Michael Passarello from the NOAA Youth Group and some of the other youth, Stefan Marin, Taylor Hernandez, are going to lead us in this reenactment. But during the reenactment, there will be fighting. And so we need to have the sound of cannons. And I don't know if this group is up for it, but what I'd like to try to do is I'd like to try to see if you folks could help me out by making the sounds of the cannons. Okay? So what I want to ask you to do as a group, can everybody look here? Can everybody look here? So when I say, I'm going to say one, two, three, and we're all going to say, boom! Okay? I want to see if we can make it loud. Did anybody ever play on a team and you do your cheer? Right? I want to hear it nice and loud. Can we try that? One, two, three, boom! That works. Okay? Now here's the deal. Because there wasn't only one side going boom, we actually need to break into groups. So we're going to have one group be the colonial American troops. So let's say that, just for practice, we said here's the line, and everybody on the left is going to be Americans, and everybody on the right is going to be British. So if the Americans were going to go fire their cannon, we would say, one, two, three,
boom!
Good. And if the British were going to fire their cannons on this side, we would say, one, two, three. Okay, so as long as you're ready, then Michael will tell you when the sounds of musket fire. That's a little preview. Now, for the reenactment, what happened in the battle was the American colonial troops came from Chelsea, which is going to be for our purposes today, all the way at the other end of the urban wild. Ah, very good. So, let's go to the other end. Let's all go to the other end of the urban wild together. Come on.
Boy.
We're going to have to go over the grass, right up over the hill. Hey, keep it coming. Come on now. Come on, Noddle Islanders. Reminds me that it's not really Chelsea, but that we're pretending it's Chelsea.
Your voice is come over on. There.
Come on, reenactors.
Use the megaphone.
They're not coming. I told them. They're not planning to come.
Come on.
Well, I think it's just building.
I don't have to read those first.
Okay, but the rest of them.
Felicitaciones.
Blow out the torch. Of our country's beginnings before they began, and who would have succeeded but for a plan. Exacted by heroes on land and on sea, to protect the first names of liberty. So we're here to celebrate the battle of Noddle Island today. But you probably do know where Noddle Island is, don't you?
Right here.
On this part of East Boston. So William Noddle settled here in 1629. This land was farmed by English settlers for almost 150 years before the Revolution. In 1775, most of the farm animals and buildings on Noddle's Island were owned by Henry Howell Williams, a farmer whose main business was selling provisions to the British. Mr. Williams was successful and well-respected. His mansion was the pride of the island, and influential people from Boston paid frequent visits to dine with Williams and his six lovely daughters, whose harpsichord playing is known for the town. After the British were forced to leave Boston on April 19, 1775, William stopped trading with the British. But the Royal Navy controlled the harbor and could easily raid island farms like Mr. Williams. Indeed, Williams was in a bad way.
Hold the mic closer.
Oliver Wendell, who raised livestock on Hog Island, which is the part of East Boston you call Lorraine Heights today, got a letter telling him of the trouble his neighbor on Noddle's Island was having. It said, because the people from the men of war, the British Navy, frequently go to the island to buy fresh provision, Mr. Williams' own safety obliges him to sell to them. On the other hand, the Committee of Safety have threatened that if he sells anything to the British, they will take all the cattle from the island. The letter added that our folks tell him they should handle him very roughly. And so on the 14th day of May, the Committee of Safety resolved it as their opinion that all the livestock be taken from Noddle's and Hog Island and driven back. And that the selectmen of all the neighboring towns shall be informed and supplied with such a number of men as they shall need. Dr. Joseph Warren, whose Warren Tavern still thrives in Charlestown, and General Artemus Ward, commander of the American forces surrounding Boston, inspected Noddle's and Hog Island, and came up with a plan to remove the farm animals from the island right up under his Royal Highness's nose. So on the 27th of May, Colonel Doolittle left with 25 men from the American Army camp in Cambridge with orders to remove the animals from the island. This group was joined by 300 men from the 1st New Hampshire Regiment under the command of Colonel John Stark. As the Americans neared Belle Isle Creek, where they planned to cross over to Hog Island, a local farmer informed Colonel Stark that about 50 British Marines had been placed on Noddle's Island in recent days. So let's trace their very steps as we travel from the shores of Chelsea and cross over the water, here represented by this path from the town of Chelsea onto Hog Island. Let's go.
Now, at about 11 a.m., between 20 and 30 minutes,
we cross the Hog Island.
It's steep excrement.
Now, perhaps you may not know this, but at low tide, you see the depth of water between Chelsea and Hog Island and the Belle Isle Creek was only knee-high, and it was possible to wade across. The same was true for the depth of water in Crooked Creek. At the crossing from Hog Island to Noddle's Island, the rest of the American soldiers followed them and began rounding up the stock on Hog Island and burning the hay there. Now, let us continue and let the quietest ones among us go and find all of the cattle upon said isle and bring them together back over the hill toward Hog Island.
Children.
Come on.
We have to go get the cattle. Let's have the children nice and quietly. Don't get seen.
Shh. I'd like to ask also some parents to go down and become our British Marines. Some parents go beyond and become British Marines near the port-a-john, where they belong.
In all, the Americans found more than they expected. They gathered 600 sheep, some cattle and horses. You guys can say, they found British naval supplies and hay. And when they set the hay on Noddle's Island on fire, they found...
One inch, please, kids, 1 inch! Don't run, please, no running! Children, don't run! Quietly now! quietly. Don't run, please don't run.
He's over there, next to the kids.
The British soldiers had seen the smoke from the fires and moved out to stop the Americans' plan. So, by 2 in the afternoon, British Admiral Graves, who had just been promoted to rank of Admiral that very morning, spotted the Americans and landed 100 more Marines to drive the Americans back. So, those would be the parents that are over there following them. So, by 2 in the afternoon, So the Diana proceeded around Noddle Island and fired on the American foragers. Can I get a few parents to go over there and be the crew of the Diana?
Oh, thank goodness you've saved the cattle.
And the sheep.
You saved the sheep. Were there any pigs?
One pig. At least one. I wonder if he's safe. Oh, here we go.
Hey, get back here!
You saved the pig.
Where are you going without food? Fire on them! Fire on them! Bang! 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 Stop! Bang! Bang!
Guys, go up the hill. Have you checked? Have you checked? Billy, cut the sound. All right, Mike.
The Americans on Noddle Island were vastly outnumbered, and seeing the additional British Marines landing, they departed.
We got ready to fire on them.
The Diana around Noddle's Island, it proceeded, and fired on the American foragers.
1, 2, 3, boom!
And the American...
3,
boom!
Take it easy.
The Americans on
boom!
Fired back, and the battle was on.
1, 2, 3, boom!
All right, let's get one from here.
1, 2, 3,
boom!
1, 2, 3, boom!
And as it continued, the British Marines departed, destroying animals, barns, and buildings, including Mr. Williams's farmhouse. It seems indeed that they had treated Mr. Williams very roughly, unwilling as they were to risk those properties once again useful to the British. The finely trained British Marines formed ranks, and as you just saw, they fired on the Americans by platoon blasting a nearly constant barrage of musket balls at the Americans. And the Americans, again, retreated onto the mainland. The warship Diana was armed with 4 cannons and 12 swivel guns, nasty little cannons mounted on stands which could swing from side to side and fire upon almost any position, and several manned barges raced into the shallow waters of Chelsea Creek to cut off the Americans' cattle drive onto Hog Island. Seeing this, the Americans sent 300 more men and 2 4-pounder cannons to Chelsea Neck, and the Diana and Americans exchanged a heavy fire. So, the Diana. All right, let's go. 1, 2, 3. We can do better than that. Come on. 1, 2, 3.
Boom!
All right, last one. This is good. Take 1, 2, 3. Okay. So the Diana received orders to withdraw, but found herself in ebb tide, and with the wind falling off, now she was unable to exit the creek. At around 6 p.m., Lieutenant Graves got all the rowboats and barges ahead of the Diana and threw them ropes which were tied to the Diana so that they could row ahead with all their might and tow the ship back out to deep.
She made it all the way to just about here, was still in trouble. So more ships, including the Britannia, were sent to her aid.
Stroke!
At about 11 p.m., the American cannon arrived and were set on the ferry. Wait, the large mechanically lifted bridge sits today, and Americans poured a heavy fire into the boats. Although one cannon burst, wounding four of the American gun crew, firing was so severe that it soon cleared Diana's desks, and the cannons on the schooner fell silent. When the Diana drifted aground on the ferryway, General Israel Putnam went down to the beach and hailed the schooner. He told them that if they left, they would have had good quarters, that they would be allowed to surrender unharmed. The stubborn British answered with two shots. The Americans fired two cannon shots, and a heavy firing began. One, two, three! One, two, three! Diana rolled over, and with Lieutenant Graves and crew now unable to stand deck nor fight, they abandoned ship and boarded the Britannia at about 3 a.m. on May 28th. The British, meanwhile, had landed more Marines on Noddle Island, along with 2 3-pounders. Later, they were reinforced by 200 more men and 2 more cannons. The Americans boarded and plundered the Diana, removing 4 4-pounder cannons from the schooner, 12 swivels, most of her rigging, including her 76-foot-tall mast and sails, clothing, and some. By daybreak on the 28th, they piled hay around her stern and set her on fire. The Britannia and British cannon on Noddle's Island tried to intervene, but General Putnam returned a heavy fire on the sloop, disabling her, and so it was thought, killing many of her crew. And she was towed off by the British boats, lest she met the same fate as the Diana. Then, just as the firing had finally died down, the Diana blew up in an explosion which could be heard for miles and miles.
One, two, three, boom!
One account stated that the rebels had lately amused themselves with burning houses on an island just under the admiral's nose, and a schooner with our cannon and some swivels, which he sent to drive them off, that unfortunately ran ashore, the rebels burned her. Admiral Graves later admitted 2 killed and 2 wounded in Somerset's boat, and several wounded in the other boats, while the Americans claimed that the British had 30 killed and 50 wounded to 5. Of the partial famine of the British troops caused by the successful American raids on the island, a famous poet of the Revolution makes the British speak, "Weeks, ye gods, nay, 3 long years, it seems, since roast beef I have touched, except in dreams. In sleep, choice dishes to my view repair. Walk waking, I gape and champ the empty air. Come, let us plan some object, ere we sleep, and drink destruction to the rebel sheep. On neighboring isles, uncounted cattle stray, fat beef, swine, and ill-defended prey. These are fit visions for my noonday dish." Later, the mast of the Diana was erected as a Liberty Pole in Prospect Hill, then part of Charlestown, now part of Somerville, and it became the first flagstaff to raise the American flag, the Grand Union flag. Now, let us turn to the final part of our reenactment, raising the Grand Union flag. Follow me.
Oh, can we have the drum music, Billy? Folks, the Grand Union flag raising is over in the far corner here. We have guns giving us a salute. Diana's mast was the first flagstaff upon which an American flag would be raised.
was raised on January 2nd, 1776, by George Washington on Prospect Hill, what was then Sutterville. And again, the pole that the flag was raised upon was one regularly here between East Boston and Chelsea. So now Mario Mendez, who by the way, pulled down flag pole, did a great job.
He's raising the Grand Union flag
over this historic battlefield.
We'll be right back. dentro de un par de minutos vamos a estar ya, estamos listos ya con los instrumentos, ya listos para preparar la rica comidita que va a haber. Gracias a la organización NOAA.
¿Y cuál es el menú de hoy?
Bueno, va a ser algo simple, pero típico americano, hot dogs y hamburguesas. Así que esperamos que deleite.
Did you guys like it?
Yes.
Ah, good. Did you like it?
What did you see when you were a little kid?
That is fantastic. Did you like it?
Good.
Very good.
I liked it.
Oh, great.
Great views of the city.
cámara, ¿qué les pareció el viaje? ¿Lo volvería a hacer?
Seguro.
Ah, bueno. ¿Se lo recomienda a la gente que lo haga?
Regatta and Re-enactment, and hope you had a great time. We look forward to doing it next year.